Hello and welcome to Simply inTAXicating. The Union Budget 2020, there was of course huge expectation and it has come out with a very clear-cut roadmap which appears to be a new taxation architecture being developed by the government. Indian Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman has actually come up with a kind of scheme shopping proposition where a taxpayer has the option whether it is a corporate or a large cooperative or individual to go for a scheme of its own choice. So the concessional corporate tax rate of 22%, then 15% for the corporate also, for the cooperative also, then for the individual, we have as many as 5 different slabs. So looking at all this, that there is clear-cut departure from the earlier thought process so far as individual taxpayers are concerned, also the corporate taxpayers, both in fact. In fact, the entire taxation as a whole, we have 4 domain experts who will look into the various finance bill provisions and also the future direction so far as indirect taxes are concerned. So far as international taxation is concerned, what are the thought process? Of course, the digital economy taxation issue is deferred, where that's the reason that a lot of provisions have been deferred, but of course there are still a few where, you know, it appears that some of the experts believe that we are trying to do a little bit of fast forwarding. So we have Mr. Akhilesh Ranjan, the former member Central Board of Direct Taxes. We have Parul Jain, partner Nishith, Desai and associates. We have Mr. V K Garg, former JSTRE and of course presently the economic advisor to the Chief Minister of Punjab. We have Mr. R. Sridhar, consulting editor TIL. So sir, let me start with you. Before the budget, it appeared that there's a lot of talk going on that your report, particularly on the DTC, probably will figure more in the budget. And how do you look at, sir, what is there? Because the report is not public, so nobody knows that how many recommendations are there or not. Mm-hmm. So broadly, sir, you know, looking at the broad recommendations which you made and the task force that submitted to the Honorable Finance Minister, how much of that you see in the final prints of the finance bill, sir?
Right. So yes, as you said, it is not being made public. There are a whole range of recommendations out there, but I believe that the report has been looked at, and that's what the minister had been saying all through. That people in the finance ministry are examining it, and I think they have had a look. There was a few central ideas which seemed to have percolated out down into this budget and even the earlier corporate tax rate reduction. One of the ideas was to bring it in a regime which is moderate and reasonable and can be stable over a period of time. And that in order to help compliance, because our major problem of raising the tax GDP ratio is through greater compliance. We still are at 6% and we really want to raise it higher. So I think this putting the structure right in personal income tax, which has been attempted, is something that we had felt very strongly about. We also had talked about removing exemptions. Now the government has done it in a different way. They've made it the two interlinked. Perhaps it might have been we would have preferred to have to let go of the exemptions on their own, just remove them completely, or not all of them, but some of them, and bring the rates down. So those things are coming. And the best thing that I note is that in the report we talked about building a relationship of trust between the taxpayer and the tax department, and we thought that was an extremely important thing for compliance to increase.
Right.
And that idea seems to be very strongly articulated in the budget, and not just the Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, but the way in which the taxpayer is now being treated, the charter, bringing the charter into the statute. All these are very positive indicators, I think, of a change in thinking, and I think a lot of work needs to be done administratively, but I think it's a very good beginning in the budget.
Right. So, Parul, how do you look at this, the announcement of charter being made a part of the statute? How important it is from the taxpayer's perspective?
I think it's really important because, you know, even if you look at internationally, for protection of taxpayer rights and also for building, you know, bridging the trust deficit between tax authorities and taxpayer, something needs to be there. I think we had a taxpayer charter which was not codified into the law, but it was more recommendatory in nature. Now to have it codified in the law, I think it will just reinforce the trust that we have in the tax department, and I think it will go a long way to bridge the tax deficit.
Right. So prime officers are looking at this announcement, of course, the charter is becoming a part of the act. On the indirect tax side, sir, I mean, do you think that, you know, similar kind of thing can be done in future, maybe in the next budget or something, sir? Maybe a part of GST also and the customs? I mean, this is possible.
See, when you hear such pleasant words,
right,
first level, you definitely feel good about it. The experience tells you that many of these things have to be backed by actions. There is a workforce in both the departments put together in excess of probably 2 lakhs or so. That means that many attitudes. So I would like to see how exactly is this tax charter backed by both the administrative will and what kind of statutory empowerment is given to the taxpayers. If somebody doesn't, let's say, follow ABC, then what will really happen to the other side of the table? That time has come. Now, when somebody pays his taxes, says, still I'm being treated like the, you know, here and there. That is a bullet, I think, that government has just begun to bite. How exactly they bite, I would like to see rest of the year.
We will get to know about it. It will unfold later. Mr. Sridhar, you of course, you will welcome it. Industry and trade and taxes,
definitely.
Large corporates will welcome it.
From the charter perspective, yes. But, I would look at it like this, that whenever we have amendments, sir is correctly saying, Mr. Garg said that, whenever we have an amendment, why can't it be looked at both provisions? Why should the industry come up and ask, why not in the indirect tax statute? They had a chance, they could have done it.
Okay.
Everything is within the control. Now, I fully agree, GST is with the council, it can't be done. But at least customs. A similar position on customs could have really enabled, you know, that will give a shift to the council to take it up for the GST portion. That could have been.
But the water testing is more from the direct tax side. No? There is
a lot of from that perspective.
Let me go to Parul. I mean, Parul, you know, one of the significant changes is being talked about, and it's generating quality debate also with respect to the residency rule.
Right.
So what are the gray areas, I mean, because before we go to sir, who will clarify some of those aspects,
right,
you know, what are the issues which you find now?
Right.
You know, because India is just trying to, you know, sort of tax those guys who are straight-laced, managing and planning their tax in such a way that they don't pay taxes in any tax jurisdiction.
Absolutely.
So what are the issues which have come up in your
mind? I think, Shailendra, you know, the whole intention behind this change in law was to, you know, like you said, bring into the tax ambit stateless people or people who are, you know, arranging their affairs in a manner that they don't pay tax in any part of the world at all, which is also sort of in line with BEPS proposals, all the more in the context of corporates, but extending that to individuals now. What actually happens, you know, intent does not necessarily always translate into the right form. And I think the day that the budget came out and, you know, we saw the provision which said that, you know, a person who's not liable to tax in any country because of the reason of domicile, residence, etc., it just created a lot of havoc. And, you know, at least we got a lot of call from people saying that, okay, now, you know, what's going to happen? I would actually technically think that, you know, and this goes back to the debate of liable to tax and subject to tax. If a sovereign nation is deciding not to levy tax on an individual because of their, you know, tax is a sovereign subject at the end of the day, you can't really be, you know, penalizing an individual for that. And I think a clarification came out subsequently, but not sure if that clarification is really good enough to really allay all the fears of, you know, people living in places like UAE. But probably a more thought of provision needs to be there. I don't think the intent was really to capture people who are working for bona fide reasons in foreign countries and ending up not paying any taxes there and to bring them into tax net in India. The other way to look at it, you know, if you look at like a country like the US, US taxes its citizens on a global basis. But is India really ready to adopt that formula?
Okay.
You know, are we really there?
So you see a shift, clear-cut shift now.
But I don't think we are really
it's not
there.
A stated policy, so we are not very clear.
Right, and I don't think we are there to really, you know, say that we will tax our citizens on, you know, on a global basis. And, you know, with the CAA coming in now also, you know, being proposed, let's see what, how that can tie in with this provision then.
Let me go to sir. I mean, sir, a lot of fear being generated, in fact, and being spread also,
yes,
that income tax authorities are going to ask you that what are the assets you have, what are the houses you have, where exactly your office is, where exactly your residence is, you know, the income, the residency certificate, and lots of documents are going to be requisitioned by the department.
Right.
So how do you look at, sir, you having gone through the provisions, you know, and the actual intent behind the provisions, sir?
So these are actually two different amendments which are interconnected.
Right, sir.
And these have been dealt with, by the way, in the task force report.
Right,
so sir. We have right, also recommended something like this. So one was partly a peculiar Indian feature where we found a number of our own residents, a large number, was managing to stay out for just more than 180 days. And although they had regular business activities in they were living in Bombay, they were living in Ahmedabad, everywhere.
Right, sir.
But they was just used to be out for some time.
Right, sir.
And they were managing to be non-residents because of that 182 days
right, sir. Correct, sir.
Out there.
Right, sir.
So that was a peculiarly Indian problem. And that time limit, in fact, was earlier, it was 90 days sometime, long time back. It was increased gradually to 182
days. 182 days, sir.
So people are taking advantage of that. We wanted to bring it down. Now that it has been brought down to 120 days means, I mean, if you're actually doing business in India, then I think it will be difficult to manage to stay out for 240 days
right,
in a whole year. So that makes it more difficult to people to evade tax. That, and I don't think there's any much of a hue and cry being raised on that point. And that comes along with the amendment saying that if you are a non-resident in 7 out of the last 10 years,
right,
then
sir.
You are still a not ordinary resident.
Right,
in a way, the government gives you 3 years to become a resident
right,
and start your compliance.
Right, sir, correct.
Even a genuine non-resident who has become a resident can take 3 years to start his process.
Right, sir.
So that's a very good, very liberal sort of amendment. And very. So if you read that along with the first one, then there's not much of harm or anything being caused by that amendment at all. This stateless business was something which is not just India, it is bothering the whole world.
Right.
There are discussions on in the OECD, in our multilateral forum, as to how do we tax stateless persons, and it's not unique to India at all. I think India has taken the lead, as we have now started making a habit of it to
right, correct. Yes.
And this is just one way of attacking it, that all right, the nexus here is this is citizenship.
Right.
If you're a citizen, correct. That means that one assumes that there is still some economic interest lying in India.
Correct. Absolutely.
And therefore, we will. And if nobody is taxing you, then we will tax you.
Right. Sir.
So, of course, it raises questions as to who is a citizen.
Yeah. Absolutely.
It raises questions of whether there are citizens of more than one country. So, there are issues to be raised.
Yes,
I think
correct.
This is an issue which will develop. We have to see how it goes. But the idea was to catch those people who are managing not to pay tax anywhere. I agree with Parul when she says that probably the drafting was not comprehensive enough.
Right, sir.
I think more factors should have been brought in there.
Yes, sir.
Just by saying not liable to tax, that term is now well understood in legal circles. And it is clear that people in UAE are not liable to tax because of their residence.
Correct. Correct. Absolutely. Yes.
So we had realized this in our task force also, and we had put something else out there.
Right. Okay.
Intention can be clear. Who are we trying to catch? We are trying to catch those people who are flitting from one country to the other, who are
correct.
Not staying anywhere for a period of time. And in this world now, in the digital world, it is possible to do so. You need not stay in a place to carry out business.
Absolutely, sir.
So
yes.
You can keep moving around. You go to South Africa and you keep doing your business in India.
Right.
And vice versa. So there's no problem. We have to somehow find a solution to this problem, because residence rules are always based on the number of days.
Right, sir.
And when you have number of days, you can easily manipulate that.
True, sir. Absolutely.
So it's a I also agree that the clarification has probably made matters worse.
No, but those amendments will come later.
I don't know. I'm not there.
When the government has come out with a press release, I'm sure that, sir, you know, that at the time of passing of the bill, the amendments will be moved.
So I've not spoken to the people in TPL on the board,
right.
So I don't know what the thinking is. But to me, it appears that the press release seems to go against the very
Correct, sir. Hurriedly issued, yes.
I think we just needed to put in some more conditions everywhere.
Correct.
So I think it's all much required.
Yes.
In this multipolar world, this global economy, we need to have these sort of provisions which, so that people can't play around with number of days to pay, decide where to pay tax.
Right, sir.
That should be removed.
So this is supposed to be, sir, anti-abuse provision. I mean, there is an anti-abuse effort here on the custom side also, sir.
You have a parallel provision to that, actually.
Yes, sir.
That somebody living abroad is essentially sending goods that may not belong to that territory, and therefore they try to avail all kind of benefits under the FTAs.
Yes, correct.
So I would, on the whole, welcome this change. We got to realize that GDP is under pressure, not only in India, all over the world. There are tendencies for greater nationalism everywhere in the world, greater protectionism, multilateralism is out. So therefore, at a time like this, two things are necessary, and I see both those changes have come into the law. The first is the rules of origin.
Yes.
They were being exploited. Now, you cannot entrust the proof of origin to the same country whose interests are getting promoted. For that country, everything they will certify.
Correct. Absolutely.
To be there. My only little issue with this change is what you are expecting the importer to do. See, unlike all other acts, custom is a very potent law. You can, besides interest and penalties, you can arrest people, and arrest is quite common in custom.
Yes.
And occasionally, coffee posa.
Yes.
Preventive detentions. Now, if you ask an importer that with his best of intentions, can he implement this law? Sitting in India, do I know how exactly, let's say, a Korea or a Thailand or some of those countries are evaluating?
Right.
Now, if I'm not in a position to do it, then to put the entire onus on me is not correct. You can ask the importer in India, you will do ABCD. Or you can prescribe as much as you like. I shall fulfill that as a part of my placing the order on my foreign supplier. But if, having got that information, something else turns out to be true, to put the entire onus on me is unfair in my understanding.
So, Mr. Sridhar, do you think that this is going to trigger a lot of litigation?
Definitely, this would, as far as... But there is one provision which I was expecting, sir, to touch upon. It also says, once it happens that a particular certificate of origin has been questioned and it has not been proved, then in respect of the same goods exported from the same country, they can put a restriction. It is there in the provision. That in my opinion, is stretching it further. I mean,
One more dimension to that.
Yes, sir.
See, you got into an agreement with a foreign country. Can you unilaterally change the law at your end?
By passing your law.
Now, what you're basically saying is that what we have signed as a part of a treaty or an agreement, there is something superimposed on that. Naturally, the other country could object that you are
I'm only
on that point. Yes. Which is exactly echoing, sir, is echoing what I said. Suppose you stop that. I forget that subsection. If you stop that, the second export coming into India, then it directly affects the FTA signed with them.
Yes.
Because the exporter in turn will go to that sovereign, whatever the jurisdiction may be, and complain.
No, but there is an income tax side, a non-cooperative jurisdiction. How we dealt with Cyprus, for instance. I think India has also a good number of FTA partners.
Yeah.
And they are not agreeing to any
immediate
amendment. There are provisions,
Shailendra, there are provisions in the agreements. Our teams are supposed to go to visit that country, see the data, and then come to the conclusion. But to have put the entire onus on the importer.
Onus on the importer, yes, sir. Probably that will create problems, sir. Yes, absolutely. Let me go back to some direct tax side. In fact, maybe Parul would like to raise some of those issues. Lots of changes, DET particularly.
Right.
How do you think, what are the concerns of the MNCs, the foreign companies, etc., or NRIs, for instance, on the DET front?
So I think, I was just hearing what, Mr. Garg was talking about, can you really change your law after having signed a treaty and unilaterally? And, for the last few years, we've been all talking about, is dividend distribution tax really a treaty override, a form of a treaty override? And if it is, then what can you really do about it? This proposal to scrap DDT, and finally, after 17 years, DDT has seen the end of its, life. I think it's a good cheer for foreign investors specifically. Two, three reasons. One is, you know, they will be able to take benefit of a lower withholding tax rate under the tax treaty as may be applicable for them. And more importantly, you know, whatever tax they're paying in India, at least, you know, they will have some clarity on whether they can utilize the tax to claim a credit in their home country. Today, what's happening is that, you know, the Indian company will pay a DDT and then the foreign investor gets the dividend. And there's lack of clarity on, you know, whether you can really claim a credit of the DDT. So there's no problem in paying the tax. The problem is in paying tax on the same income in two countries.
Right.
And, you know, there have been certain cases also that have been filed, you know, saying that, you know, we can still go under the tax treaty. So at least I see a lot of those issues getting resolved.
Okay.
Investors, you know, getting to pay the tax that should ideally be due from them. And they can also claim a credit in their home jurisdiction. I think also from the Indian company's perspective, currently what happens is, you know, if an investor or an Indian company receives dividend from another company, there is a dividend received deduction. There's a form of a dividend received deduction that exists in law today. The manner in which the dividend received deduction law is being proposed now, it's more comprehensive, you know, without really going into the technicalities. And I think overall it's going to be much, much better for companies. Investors can also take a deduction for expenses they have incurred in earning dividend income. So, you know, while we are all talking about how this could not be so beneficial for non-corporates and individual investors, I actually think, you know, if you look at the economic impact of it, ultimately, the company has more money to pay out as dividend because it's paying the dividend distribution tax. Now, it does not have to pay dividend distribution tax. Individuals don't have to pay the extra 10% tax, which would be, you know, leviable if they earn dividend more than 10 lakhs. And they can also claim a deduction for interest, you know, so if they borrowed money to invest in a company, they can claim a deduction.
Yes, absolutely.
So I think that's very positive on the whole, you know, scrapping of this. It's very welcoming. It was anticipated and, you know, we were hoping, you know, the Honorable Finance Minister will go ahead with it. And, you know, three cheers to her for actually going ahead and doing it.
So, sir, was it a part of DTC report?
Oh, yes, of course.
Yes, sir.
It's a very logical step, you know. I mean, if you talk of corporate taxation, you can't talk of just the corporate tax rate.
Right, sir.
You have to talk of dividends. You have to talk of capital gains.
Right, sir.
All three are components of taxing corporate profits at one level or the other. So, yes, certainly. And we had very clearly, and this is one, something which is very closely on the lines of what we have said in the DTC, what has come out. You see, if you're trying to rationalize the corporate system, which we already started doing that by reducing the rates and all, then you can't have an aberration like the DDT. The DDT had become an aberration.
Right, sir.
You're an outlier in the world. No other country is doing it. You have these problems that it doesn't come under the treaties. So foreign investors are shouting about it.
Right.
You have disputes in courts, already cases going on, saying that no, we should still get credit. And there are the industries saying that, look, my cash flow is being ruined and you are taking away my resources.
Right.
So I think in all ways, it is something which was required to be done to go back to a proper system, the right system. And let's not get too worried about whether that is going to hurt industry or not hurt industry, but it should be the right way of taxing.
Right.
And then industries will then adapt to that.
Right.
But the first thing to have is to have a reasonable and correct tax structure in place. And that's what I think you've done. There are many spin-offs also out there. I don't know, the dispute on Section 14A.
Right, sir.
Yeah.
Correct.
That will come to an end. At least.
Correct.
Half the cases in High Court.
On 14A?
Delhi High Court itself, you can write a book on the Delhi High Court judgments.
Yes. Yes. Supreme Court already.
You can write
two judgments. Huge
number of decisions.
So all because of, you know, how what to set off against exempt income. Now if you're not exempt income anymore, then the whole thing goes. At the same time, on the converse side, there are other issues. What happens to the buyback tax?
Yes, correct.
There are many structures that we built up over the years because we had a DDT.
Right, sir, correct.
The InvITs have a problem,
right?
The trust, business trust.
Who
the main thing for business trust was to was the dividend exemption from DDT.
Yes, sir.
Now they are chargeable. So probably there are issues which the government will look at gradually and try and sort out. But it's something which is required to be done.
Even in the mutual fund industry, instead of people going in for the dividend-based schemes, they will go more for growth-based schemes.
Yes.
Rather than tax it as a capital gain, they would prefer to tax it. I'm talking about an average Indian investor.
Yes.
finding that the dividend is going to be taxed in his hands, will go for a from a mutual fund, I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's a clear
step forward. 115 RM. So it should be there with the investors. So right. That's what I'm saying. You have a reasonable, proper tax structure, and then leave it to the market to devise what they want to do.
Yeah. But I think, sir, just on the invit part, and you know, would like to love to hear your thoughts, specifically from foreign investor perspective. Of course, we all know that, you know, earlier dividends were exempt through and through for investors in a business trust, and now they have to pay tax on dividend income. Under the tax treaty, you know, and most of these, let's say, you know, funds are based in Singapore, and you know, they're investing in an invit or a REIT in India. Under the tax treaty, you can get a benefit of a lower withholding tax rate if there's an Indian company that is distributing dividends to the shareholder. And there is a lower tax rate if the shareholder is holding at least 25 or, you know, more than 25% of the shares. At least that's the language in the Singapore treaty. Now here we have a Singapore resident who's holding units of an InvIT, and the InvIT is holding shares of an SPV. So contextually, if you apply the treaty, investors should still get the lower withholding tax rate, but have we really increased the litigation on that side?
No, so those are valid points. I think the fact that the government had all along consciously given the exemption from DDT meant that we have already said that we will not charge you one tax on the dividend. That's one of the selling points of the InvIT,
and
how do we attract the REIT and the InvITs. So I'm sure that we will be found by the government. This discussion
some
will go on.
Will
a number of issues have to be seen, as you rightly said, depending on where the InvIT is located, where is the investor located, what are the relationships, and do we have to maintain the attractiveness of business trust? Then I personally feel that something will have to be done.
A lot of pressure from business trust.
So, sir, before we discuss other issues, sir, in fact, this Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, sir, you know, which has been, you know, the details have been tabled in the House yesterday. Very similar to, you know, what Sir has just experienced, because the Sabka Vishwas. And to what extent, sir, do you think that, you know, this scheme is going to be, and from the taxpayer perspective, how attractive it is? And this, of course, the government will not have any target, maybe internal target they will have. But of course, sir, you know, I mean, do you think that we could have, I mean, the
when the details of the scheme will come out, because that's very important.
It is already out.
Bill
has been table in the House, in fact. So, sir, how, I mean, do you think this could have been made more attractive?
No, I don't think it would have been made more. I think this is the most attractive you can make it for income tax purposes.
Okay, sir.
By saying that I will not charge you any interest
in
any penalty.
Penalty, and yes. No, so these two gone, yes, sir.
So, nothing more could be done on there.
Right, sir.
Such schemes have come earlier.
Right, sir.
The Karvevad Samadhan
in
1998,
sir.
Then the scheme of 2016. They were not very successful. Because income tax litigation is slightly different from the GST litigation
or
the central excise litigation that we had, where it was one issue or two issues of classification. Here there were several issues of a very, very intense question of law which were being debated. But this time, this scheme, I think and I hope that it will work because of the very large number of disputes relating to the penny stock cases.
Right, sir.
And the post-demonetization, the cash deposit cases. There are a very large number of those cases.
Right, sir.
And if I think it's just an ideal thing for those people. In fact, it's a sort of an amnesty for them.
Yes, correct.
That you have done all your thing, but now you pay just tax. You already taken 3 years. You held the money.
Right, correct.
Right, enjoyed yourself.
Right.
Fine. And now you pay the tax and go and walk away. I think it's a fantastic amnesty scheme for those categories of fees. So I think they should come in hand, and I'm sure there must be an internal thinking, because if 1170 is the revised estimate for indirect tax collection.
Yes.
1170,000.
Yes.
Last year was 1130.
Yes, correct.
So I'm sure that this must have been factored into as a cushion somewhere to come.
What happens to the 43B which I have disallowed earlier, and if I now settle and pay? What will happen to that?
Well, I haven't thought of that. I think what you're doing out here is just resolving one dispute.
Because I have not read the bill, as sir said, that it has been placed in the parliament. Yes. It was placed yesterday.
So all you're doing is you're withdrawing one appeal.
That's all.
Now, how that impacts your other years and all is for you to think.
Okay, sir.
But it,
because
it,
I would have disallowed
the scheme doesn't say that.
I created a provision and disallowed it.
So you just decide. You know the facts. You know your case. You know how it will impact your other 5 years. But this is the year, and I've got 3 years. This matter is pending in my case in the ITT. I want to settle it, and you withdraw those appeals, and then you see how it's entirely up to the thing. So it's a good scheme. The idea is very good, as I said.
Yes.
Of now saying that okay, we want to give you a chance and give the tender taxpayer that please come out clean and be a fine, no penalty for you, no interest and no prosecution. And I think that's something that's very much required as a building.
Liquidate that tax area.
Well, I would have, of course, this is preferred to also go further, as I said, to have a scheme which can prevent further disputes from also arising.
Correct.
The really complicated one, the questions of law, where we thought that there was a talk of some mediation process or something. I think that those are the things maybe one could have hoped for. Maybe that's something.
But mediation was something which were recommended by the DTC.
That's right. That's right.
Oh, right. Okay. What I was telling Shailendra is the fact that I was only pointing out on the 43B because of the connection of you said about Sabka Vishwas and asking Mr. Garg. Because there I would have taken as an expenditure the excise duties or whatever it is. And that scheme has come. I would have offered it. Now that I am entitled to, am I entitled to a 43BB, that settlement? That is what I was asking, sir. In that, I mean, that has not got a direct connection to the income tax scheme.
Yeah.
But the fact that I have provided earlier years and I didn't pay it and it got disallowed. Now with this scheme, if I had offered, then what will happen to that? Because then that will be, it will be as much as a double whammy, isn't it? I've held back.
Yeah.
I have held back for so many years. Should you allow me a 43B deduction at all? Now, just because I settled that excise duty with the department, I disallowed it then.
No, a lot of unique cases will come up. For instance, there is this Section 148 notice being issued. And the SSC decide, taxpayer decides to file a writ. The case is pending in the High Court, sir. Meanwhile, the assessing officer is finalizing that demand. Demand is articulated now and it is assessed. The demand order is issued, but the case is pending. So now, you know, somebody asked us in the morning, am I eligible? Going by those details, I said, well, this has to be examined and CBDT will have to come up with some FAQs.
Like they came on
this kind of situation, yes, sir. You know, probably that will help.
In the indirect side, they came out with about 4 to 5 circulars, and it was really explained well.
I think that is required. That is certainly required. I'm sure. I know that TIOL is working on that.
Right, sir.
Is working on that. So these are things that will be clarified out there.
Right, sir. So you have a prima facie view on this kind of a scheme, you know, which government is coming up with. You know, of course, a lot of good number of states have come up with respect to VAT.
VAT,
you know, the old
Bombay came up. Bombay came up after. After GST.
So all the states have come up with four different kind of amnesty scheme. And the last one, Gujarat.
Jammu Kashmir came up.
So, sir, how do you look at, sir, you know, the fiscal, the expert, how do you look at this?
See, these, in my personal view, are aberrations. The primary intent of any government should be to nip the litigation in the bud. I don't see that happening. In fact, if you see in the GST, I think it is going to be a lawyer's paradise. So, and it is so easy today to look at the possible litigation, the litigation that has already happened, and so on and so forth. But 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line, there will be another amnesty and so on and so forth. So an amnesty basically means the government is foregoing the future revenue at a hugely discounted amount. Now it looks very fine to everybody because government of the day gets some revenue, the taxpayers get some relief. But you know, nothing is free in a country. It means the future generation has paid the price of the present reward. Is it a fair reward? Let the future people judge.
Right, absolutely. Mr. Sridhar, Alan, before we touch other issues, maybe the tedious part you wanted to discuss.
Tedious part, two, three issues. One is the fact that this is on the sale of goods in 206C.
Okay.
Now, if you see the consideration in the tedious part, it talks about the consideration received by the concerned person who is the seller of the goods. That includes the GST.
Okay.
So why should a person pay 0.1% on the GST which is collected and paid to the government? That would be slightly.
You want an answer?
Yeah, least there should be a further clarification on consideration. That is one aspect to it. And second thing, there is with regard to this liberalized scheme of 7.5 lakhs, the authorized exchange dealers, being allowed to collect, deduct, I mean, tax and source.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Now, that, you know, that is really very important, because under the liberalized scheme, you're allowed to remit, if I'm not, I don't know the exact limit now, I think it's 2,50,000 dollars.
Now,
where is 2,50,000 dollars and where is 7.5 lakhs? That is one. And in terms of education, right, that's the biggest drain as far as that is concerned. Now, if I have to pay 5% on that, considering that if you look at the entire middle class that educates their children abroad. I'm not saying the other classes don't. I'm not saying that. Because the brunt is always borne by the middle class. Both sides, they escape, and the middle gets cut in
between.
Middle,
so you have to bear that.
Yeah.
Yes.
So therefore, the brunt which they have to pay extra 5% is very unfair, because cost of education. I did a small research on US universities on LLM. It took me nearly 3 hours of reading to what LLM. I divided that entire research into two. If you were a part of Ivy League, you are not a part of Ivy League. Nothing less than $60,000 is the coaching fee.
Right.
Now, what is $60,000 multiplied by 71 rupees? And where does the money come from? And on top of that, if I have to pay 5%, and invariably a person who's working in the government sector may be borrowing from a commercial bank for educating his daughter for the purpose of the future. So what, and those set of people, and then if you go and see the memorandum, it has been highlighted under deepening tax measures. Mm-hmm. My only point is these guys are definitely paying tax and their returns are definitely being fined.
So
and we are looking at the long avenues.
So you are deeply hurt about
deeply
it.
Deeply hurt.
So we'll go to Sir Lam. So these are some rational.
Yeah, rational.
I'm sure the DTC has not recommended that. I can
do that. No, the DTC has not recommended this, of course, but then we wanted to tighten up the withholding tax provisions.
Right, sir.
Anyway, but here the logic is that it has been noted by the government that this the LRS was being used to send out a whole lot of money, and when you analyze the reasons given in the statements given to the authorized dealers, I mean, they were. It seemed that the money was just flowing out without any check. It wasn't for the right purpose. When you say that these writers must be taxpayers, no. When we examined some of these cases, you know, 15 CA forms have to be filled up, and we also wanted to know
yes,
whether TDS have been done or not. And there were several cases we found of people had just floated companies in Hong Kong. You can form a company in Hong Kong sitting in your computer out here. And you start sending out money as whatever, software charges,
yes,
these charges, these fees, that fees. We found that the people who were sending out the money were fraudulent.
So laundering was going on.
Shailendra, the point is also, constitutionally, this is a tax on income. Slowly, you're getting a feeling it's becoming a tax on transactions.
Yes.
See, that's a larger issue. Very valid and a larger issue.
And also, sir, if you look at it from a taxpayer's perspective, sir has talked about corporate or institutions misusing. Mm-hmm. But here, the logic of the section is every person being an authorized exchange dealer has to collect, it says. So it will also include individuals who are procuring foreign exchange mm-hmm. from their accounts. And this is out of expenditure. Then you go to foreign true travel operators. Now, anybody who's going on a foreign travel can be an individual also.
That is also,
in my opinion, that is out of my tax. That is out of my tax paid salary. If I get a good bonus, I will take my family out to Malaysia and Singapore. Mm-hmm.
So I think the logic there was, as the FM has been saying, that look, you're going to credit for that.
Right, sir.
You're a taxpayer.
That is true, sir. That is not denied.
I mean, these things were already there, like the TCS on motor cars.
Right, correct.
It's already there. So you do get a credit for that. It becomes part of your tax if you buy it.
Then
car.
One should look at the percentage of refunds income tax is giving to the total income.
That is a fairly high percentage.
I'm told it's a fairly high percentage for a tax department.
Those are valid issues, and that's why we have to calibrate the limit.
Yes.
Now, I don't know how the 7.5 lakhs was arrived at.
Because I compared the two limits.
And maybe this 5% perhaps were a little higher.
Yeah.
I mean, 5% is... If the idea was to gather data...
As it is, my tax is fully getting recovered. I'm not going to be spared on the salary side.
Right.
Just because I'm paying 5% here for educating my child abroad. Mm-hmm. That is not going to be spared to me.
Right.
Because the 192 obligation still remains full as far as any employee is concerned.
So before we wrap up, Parul, you have any point where, you know, the SCP particularly, I believe you have a point.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. So I think, like Sir mentioned, you know, we are very advanced when it comes to, you know, taxes.
Yeah, even equalization levy for that matter.
Equalization levy. We brought in the SEP rule while it was still in a proposal stage. Now the SEP rule has been postponed by a year, and the whole logic is that, you know, since there is still international discussion regarding, you know, what should be the appropriate thresholds, and there's still a talk regarding nexus going on. India has, you know, we've decided to already, there's a proposal to defer it by 1 year. But on the flip side, now there is a proposed attribution rule, which applies to SEP cases and non-SEP cases both.
Right.
And the way the attribution works is that, you know, if there's a person who's residing in India, now it's not residential status, but it's a person residing in India. If, you know, he's just, you know, you collect some data from that person, or, you know, through an internet protocol, that data is used to sell any goods or services, and it doesn't matter where you're selling the goods or services. The attribution belongs to India. You have to attribute a part of the, you know, the sale to India. So imagine a foreign company. And of course, you know, physical presence has outlived its utility. But to, you know, are we really then saying that nexus is tied to an internet protocol? Is that what we're really saying? Or is it, you know, the pillar one talks about, you know, nexus being tied to revenue and to the users in India, and that's what the SEP law also talked about. But somehow this attribution rule, while for SEP cases it's been postponed, but there are a lot of question marks around, you know, and also, you know, along with the data laws in India, how that's really going to work, I think.
Probably
that's
we are getting ready for this BEPS 0.1, you know. I mean, that is where, you know, there's a lot of data we are, you know, gathering and preparing ourselves. That if OECD comes up with a solution, we should have the data with the CBDT to levy taxes. So maybe sir would like to throw some more light.
Yeah, so when we brought in this SEP in the law, we wanted to make a statement. We wanted to make a statement saying that this is what India believes in. And this has been our stand consistently internationally. But then when you bring something to the law, then you're supposed to make rules to prescribe thresholds. When we wanted to do that, then by that time the discussions had picked up pace. The G20 now has categorically come out with a mandate saying that you will find a solution.
Yes,
you will find a consensus solution. So therefore, in the light of that mandate, then it's something, I mean, that the discussions are bound to lead to somewhere, which international community will have to agree to. It is because of that we said we were unable to prescribe the rules, although to prescribe thresholds, the same things were being talked about internationally. And now that there is such a clear mandate, I think that's the decision taken to formally defer it. It's there in the statute, but it's deferred by 1 year. The assumption being that by December 2020, a consensus should come about in these multilateral discussions. That is what is hoped for. The G20 is expecting that. So it's based on that. Now, on the other attribution part, yeah, that's not directly related. But then, if you have gone through those papers as to how to allocate income, those discussions that are happening, not just in the digital models, but also in the non-digital business models, then there is although there is a realization that data is important, there is no weightage actually being given to data in all those calculations. You apply a revised residual profit split, so you apply a percentage.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You're not going by the amount of data, you're going by the amount of revenue only.
Right.
Right? So, although the starting point of the whole debate was that it is because of data that these services are becoming valuable and taxable out here. It is because of data that you can do business in a country without actually being there,
without having any PE. Yes.
So all those three limbs of the new clause that have been put in, they are essentially saying that if the data is Indian data, then any exploitation of the Indian data must be compensated.
Yes.
That's the broad logic.
Right.
So that's why the IP address. Okay, the customer who places the ad with Google may be different. He is making the payment. But the value of that payment is that user, who is another person.
Yes.
Who is Indian.
Indian.
Who has given his data.
Yes. Right.
And that data, he is not getting anything out of it. The company only is making money out of it.
Yes, absolutely.
So we are saying in that amendment that look, no, we must get a compensation. Now, Very difficult question. Is it something which is even the data protection bill, which is pending in Parliament, is talking about?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you want to say that Indian data is Indian data?
Is Indian data.
Right?
Correct.
It's the same logic. Now, how do we actually value it? How will we find out these things as to who is sitting in some Netherlands has sold a data which is belonging to an Indian data center? We don't know, but that's something
that
will happen.
Yeah, and today, sir, I can actually access, some streaming site for movies through an offshore VPN.
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
How will someone really, keep a tab on which internet protocol belongs in, this is coming from India?
Yes, certainly to levy entertainment tax in Punjab on streaming and some of those.
Yeah, absolutely, sir.
So it's very complex, but I think the logic here is that it is an enabling provision. So the tax law, domestic tax law, says that you can tax it. Now you have to find a way of doing it. But the law says that you can tax it. And that's why it says that the attribution will include.
Yes.
So it's not to say that this will be the only attribution.
Yeah. There will be many other.
But this will include wherever applicable. Yeah. Obviously. That's the next two words.
Sir, I think the only question that was coming in most of our minds is that, and of course, this attribution rule is for digital as well as non-digital, like you said. And for non-digital, it applies, from 1st of April this year. For digital, it will apply from next April when ACP also comes into effect.
Correct.
And considering the whole international consensus and the G20 mandate and, the fact that the Pillar 1 final recommendation is, we are still tying up on all those things, wouldn't it just have been better to wait for another year and, just come out with the final rules? We already have a Rule 10, which gives the AO as much power to do what
he can. We take time to understand and,
This is still very evolving.
Providing data also.
And it's very complicated as well.
The corporates.
And I think finally, you must ask, sir, whether they have budgeted some money for this before 31st March on this direct tax. Vivad se Vishwas. They would have budgeted some money.
We don't know. But
they have not.
As I said, the revised estimate is 11 lakhs. The figures were rather falling short of that. So there must be some element of.
Some element they will have. Mm-hmm. But here, let me add that, the G20 thing, India is going to host that G20 meeting in 2022. We have already allocated 100 crores. So we are gearing up for that, So this is. Sir, and before we wrap up, on the GST front, sir, of course, some of the amendments are there in the part of the finance bill, but how do you look at the future direction? Sir, Honorable Finance Minister made several announcements on the floor of the House.
See, my big worry this time in the budget is the duty on cigarette, which is a GST item. So very technically speaking, center had the power to levy it. But I would say they are very much on the border to have breached the understanding with the states. Because what had happened was there is a GST component to 28%. There is a cess component, which was supposed to have equalized the excise duty. So whatever NCCD was there, one would have imagined it's kept constant, particularly when there is pressure on the compensation cess. Compensation cess is falling significantly short of the requirements.
Yes.
For center to have unilaterally increased NCCD and left states high and dry is not how a person would like a federal system to work.
That one doubt also is there from a constitution perspective. Sir is the right person. When the framework was done, there are certain items which were left for the power of a central excise duty also to be connected. So this same question would have come when the constitution bill is also passed, that for example, you kept it on cigarettes, they have the power to levy. So they have levied that, and it is coming within that schedule in the Finance Act 2001 only they bought it in. So when they passed it also, the suspicion would have been in the mind of the states, sir, when the constitution amendment bill was passed.
Is only for a period of five years. Once it has gone, state kept the excise on liquor. Center said, I will keep the excise on cigarettes.
Right.
So one same item. But then everything which was over and above the usual taxes was subsumed into the cess. Like coal cess was subsumed and so on. So only the oil, because oil was not subsumed, the OIDB
cess
was
kept outside. Yes.
Now this is the first time that center has done that. And that too at a time when states are not really getting compensation on time. Now, I think there was a statement in the budget speech that states will now be compensated only and only out of the compensation cess, whatever be the amount. As of now, the compensation cess might just be sufficient to give 7 months of compensation, maybe 6.5, maybe just 6.
Correct.
So that means states will start getting roughly half the amount what they are otherwise promised.
Entitled to, correct.
Many states have said it is a sovereign default. I would not like to use such a strong term, but there was a certain amount of central assurance to the states that please sign on dotted lines.
Yes, sir.
And so on and so forth. So one really wonders that if states do not get the compensation, I mean, whether the entire, you know, structure that has been created on GST is it in doubt. I can see so many loopholes in the constitutional amendment that as soon as 2022 June arrives and the state is not getting the right amount of money, how will they break the consensus? And this whole design of IGST is such that if one state breaks, then it sets a chain reaction.
Yes.
See, we haven't followed the European model of GST, that if one country wants to misbehave or do anything, it doesn't impact the others, because goods are zero rated when they move from one state, one country of EU to others. Here, that is not the scheme. So one has to really understand that it is playing with the fire. That has to be extremely carefully done. The second is, now we are getting very close to 3 years of GST. So one would have expected that, yes, there will be challenges and issues of GST. But certain things one should have, I think 3 years is too much of a time. And one of the things is just the compliance procedure. And you can't be just kind of having whatever returns you thought of on the July 1st, 2017. Yes. It has not yet become operational. So I would have liked to believe that, yes, while you will require a certain amount of incrementalism for whatever reasons now that GST got into some bit of a problem, do not lose sight of the larger picture. What kind of a GST country should have or should have had, let's say now 3 years or 4 years down the line, then roll back that vision. Today I feel you face a problem, some court does something, you in the next meeting there is a change, either a circular or an amendment or a rate change or this and that. You ask anybody, he doesn't seem to be getting any question, why a rate on X item is this, Y item is this, and similar thing. One day we have to set it right. Now, if we don't do when states are signing on the dotted lines, states are not going to agree from 2022. It's going to become increasingly difficult. Right. So this is, you got roughly about a year to set the structure right, whether it is on tariffs, whether it is on the structure of the law, and so on and so forth. And I wish it is set right quickly rather than later.
Right. So on this note, let me thank all my four guests for making wonderful, insightful suggestions. And as Mr. Garg rightly suggested, that this NCCD on tobacco and tobacco products and cigarettes, etc., are actually going to trigger a serious, probably some amount of fireworks at the GST Council meeting, where the states, in any case, they are crying for more compensation. Compensation pool itself doesn't have enough money to compensate them. So, as rightly suggested, that it's going to be a case of sovereign default. It's a big challenge for the central government, which is, having deficit on the direct tax side as well. Of course, the Vivad Se Biswas scheme perhaps will compensate to some extent, but going by the projections for the next fiscal also, on the direct tax side, there is, going by the GDP growth rate, of course, there is a lot of strain on the corporate side also. So, and of course, the elective scheme, the Honorable Finance Minister came out this time for the individual taxpayers. We will have to see how exactly it works, how many takers are going to be there in the economy for this scheme. But international taxation side, of course, some of the measures which have been taken and which were recommended by the task force on DTC are little foresighted, futuristic, and probably India is gearing up to align a lot of provisions with the global decisions where the G20 is going to play a very critical role. So let's look forward to a little more stable tax regime in future on the direct tax side as well as the indirect tax side. GST is the only one where perhaps, you know, we would be going through more experiments where many stakeholders are involved, and the GST Council will have to take a little more serious call on various other contentious issues. Thanking you all for watching TIOL TUBE.